You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
Hello, and welcome to episode 194 of the Soul Forge podcast.
Welcome to the Soul Forge, a place of silent mystery, quiet contemplation, and outright mayhem. Join your host, Sean Vanderloo, as he guides you through the adventures of living. Together, we'll talk about life and love, sex and dating, joy and heartache, memories and loss, and so much more. Don't worry, it's not nearly as pretentious as it sounds. Get ready for life, the universe, and everything on the Soul Forge.
Hey everybody, it's Sean back at you here with another episode of the podcast, and this time I've got a special guest. You may know him from the Two Stoned Dudes podcast. You know that I was on his show last week, and he's here on my show this week. How are you, Ryan?
I am doing well, sir. Thank you so much for having me on. I really appreciate it.
Oh, definitely. My pleasure. My pleasure. Was there any reaction to my guest spot on your show there last week?
Quite a bit, actually. Yeah, you had a lot of people laughing.
Is that right?
Plenty of people sent us. We had a bunch of emails and a bunch of people talking to us from our WordPress website, and they definitely got a kick out of you, man. You hit a home run.
Oh, good. That's what I like to hear. And if that eventually translates into some more listeners for my shows, that would be awesome too. But if not, at least we made people laugh.
Right. Right.
So, like I said, you're the host of the Two Stoned Dudes podcast. So it's you and one other guy, or is there four other people?
There's actually four other people. It just kind of got added on. It was just me. I actually originally called it the One Stone Dude podcast because I couldn't get one of my friends to do it with me.
Oh, no.
So, yeah. So I said, all right, I'll just do it like that for however long I have to do it for. And like by the third or fourth show, my buddy Rob the Nod decided to jump on. We met through work, and then my friend Kevin decided to jump on. And then we needed like an actual studio. So we got to a longtime friend of ours, this guy Mondo, and he pretty much built a studio at this like mini recording studio that he had in his house.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, and that's how we got our studio sound that we have now.
Oh, perfect. And
before I was just recording everything off my phone.
Yeah, that's how you start. Like people know, I started with an old iPad and a $20 Amazon microphone, and I've recently upgraded my equipment slowly over time. So yeah, you get better as you go.
Yeah, man, especially we got this thing. Like, Mondo is, like, cool about putting money into the podcast. I tell him not to do it, but he does it anyway. He went and got this thing called Rodecaster Pro. I think it's, like, $400 friggin'. I couldn't believe he got it. Like, and he basically said, don't worry about paying me back. We're just having fun with this. So it worked out, I guess.
Yeah.
It's fun. It's a lot of fun.
That's a nice piece of equipment. I've been looking at it over the last few months, but it's a little bit out of the price range right now. So it can do a lot of different things, though, right?
Yeah, the four of us that we gel together, and we've been really trying not to talk over top of each other. But you know, once we got like the studio down, the earphones working and microphones working, everything, you can really tell when you're about to talk over somebody because you can hear them talking in your headphones. It just makes it a little easier now.
Oh yeah. There's a lot of complicated stuff behind the scenes that listeners who don't podcast don't actually know about. But that's all part of the fun, right?
Right. Absolutely.
If our listeners wanted to find your podcast, where are some of the places they could do that?
We're on Anchor. That's our home spread right there. Anchor.fm. We're on Podbean. We're on Apple Podcasts. There's a bunch of different platforms. I haven't even really been able to keep track.
So
like I'm the one that does all the social media and all that stuff. So it's kind of my job to do all that stuff. It's a pain in the butt, but I manage to do it.
Yeah, it's almost like if we had social media secretaries to do all the promotion for us, it would make our life so much easier.
Well, I know there's people that pay for that, man, and they God bless them, they can afford it. Good for them.
Yeah,
but it's all homegrown here.
Same. Yeah, I do all this for the love of it. It costs a fortune, and I don't get any money out of it. But hey, that's not what it's about, right? It's a hobby.
It's about having fun, and that's what we do. We definitely have fun. On our show, I haven't listened to too many people besides yourself. You seem to have a blast all by yourself. no matter who you got on the show, the four of us, we just gel really well. We come together because we're all cannabis enthusiasts, and we all have our medical cards, which you have to have in the U.S. in Arizona at least. I think California ought to have cards as well. Not sure. Anyway, besides that, before I get into rambling, we don't all come together at once for a show. Sometimes it's three, sometimes it's two, sometimes it's all four. But magic does happen because we all get in each other's conversations and we kind of all feed off each other really energies like really well. So it all blends together.
That's what it's all about. So what we'll do before we get into the main topic, I'm just going to go ahead and play a promo for another podcast right here on the ESO Network, and then we'll come right back.
Attention, people of Earth! Looking for a way to kill half an hour every week?
Try the Flopcast! It's a silly podcast about cartoons, music, comics, movies, obscure pop culture from the 70s and 80s, and chickens.
Join us! Bring coffee!
We're on the ESO Network.
And we're at flopcast.net.
And wasn't that a great promo, Ryan? Didn't you love that? Aren't you going to check out that podcast?
Yes,
I knew it. I knew it.
Absolutely.
Okay, cool. And that's what it's all about. So just to transition over here into what we're going to talk about, as I was on your show last week and we were talking about cross-promotion and being on each other's shows and stuff, and you said, what's the Soul Forge all about? And I said, well, it's about stupid things we do for love. It's about pretty much anything to do with life. And you said, well, I've got stories about life. And so I said, well, why don't you come on the show? And guess what? Now here you are.
Yeah, I'll get into it, man. Look, I'm 42 years old. I turned 42 March 17th, and I've done a lot of things with my life. I have a lot of stories from different things that I've done. High school, you kind of just don't count because that's high school. You have stupid high school stories. But I got to serve in the United States Marine Corps. I was a professional wrestler. I actually might get back into that. I've been married. I have a kid. I can't really think of anything else to say right now. Oh, my God. I'll tell you a quick story.
Sure.
Real quick story.
Okay.
It's a wrestling story. Okay.
Yeah.
So we were on our way to New Mexico. It was me and three other guys. We were on our way to New Mexico. Okay. That's how wrestlers travel. We travel on packs because it saves gas money that way. Stick four or five guys in the car and you're good to go. On the way, I had to go to the bathroom and there wasn't a restroom for miles. So I have to, you know, do what a man does. You go creep up in the bushes and do your thing.
Yeah.
Well, underneath of me, did not see it, didn't hear it, nothing, was a baby javelina.
A baby what?
And I peed right on. It's a, what do you call it? A wild hog. It's like a wild boar. It's got piss and shit. It's pretty nasty looking. Anyway, so I pissed on it accidentally. And this thing screamed. And its mother came through and its mother started coming through the brush.
Uh-oh.
Well, needless to say, I didn't have everything buckled and all together, and I started running to the car, and put it this way, everybody else in the car could see what religion I am.
Nice.
It's pretty horrible.
It sounds pretty horrible.
Anyway, that's just one of the things. It wasn't even that. It was funny, you know.
Yeah, for sure.
I had a
good
time with it.
Let's talk about a little bit about your wrestling, because my brother is a huge fan of wrestling, and he's done it as a hobby for years. What was your wrestling name? What was the outfit that you worked for? Give us some background.
Well, I started out as Ryan Castle. That's the name I used for the podcast too. Then I went to my real name. It's Ryan Castellucci, and that's what I mainly went under. You can YouTube me, and you'll find some of my matches on there. I wrestled for a couple different companies all over the – I actually wrestled to the East Coast, the West Coast. I wrestled up north and down south, as a matter of fact. I didn't get a chance to travel outside of the country, but I've been to damn near every state in the country wrestling.
Oh, wow. That's amazing.
Yeah, I worked for a bunch of different companies.
Were you ever in the WWE?
Oh, no. I wish I would have had the chance, but I kind of started late in wrestling. I started at 29. Usually guys are starting like they're way early 20s, and WWE has a certain wellness – part of their wellness policy is they don't take anybody over 27 right off the bat.
Okay.
So no matter how long you've been on, no matter how long you've been in, if you're over 27, they're really not looking at you.
Gotcha.
For the insurance policy. So, but it was a dream. It was something I wanted to do. And you know what got me into it? I have to tell a story. Not a story, but how I got into wrestling. My dad was actually a professional wrestler.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, he did. He would do. He did wrestling to actually help supplement his child support payments.
Oh wow! Okay,
that's why he started wrestling.
Oh, that's awesome.
So, yeah, to help me and my sister out. So my dad wanted to be a good dad by being a professional wrestler. It's pretty funny. And that's what got me into it. He brought me to my first independent wrestling show. And the most famous people that I met when I with him there was called the Freebirds. And they were from World Class Championship Wrestling down in Texas. And then I got to meet the Road Warriors, which were pretty cool. Yeah, that's after that.
Okay, well, that's cool. That's cool. Now, before we started recording, we were talking about some of the subjects or some of the topics that we might want to get into here on your first guest spot on SoulForge, because it sounds like you have a lot of stories and you might want to come back. But you said you had a pretty cool virginity story. Is that true?
Yeah. Okay. Well, call it cool, call it stupid, call it what you want. I'll tell it to you. So I get a phone call from this girl who was quite a few years. She was 17 and I was 14. And she was the older sister of two girls that I went to class with. She saw a picture of me and decided that for some reason I'd be somebody that she'd want to hook up with. So New Year's Eve, she came over to my friend's house. We started out doing what we were doing, and most guys' first time don't last that long. I couldn't tell you in seconds how long I lasted, but I remember just trying to think of everything else I could to avoid finishing.
Right.
And I thought of baseball. And I remember thinking, John Kruk. Oh, he's only got one nut. Nut, nut, no, that's it. Oh, and it was done.
Oh, man.
And it was over with. Just, yeah. And she was like, is that it? And I was like, yeah, that's pretty much all I got right now. Thanks, I appreciate it. Thanks for playing.
Right,
right. Have a good day.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's cool, though, that she was 3 years older and she saw you and you're like, hey, that's the one for me.
Yeah, you know what? She continued. We continued to have a sexual relationship for about a good 4 or 5 months after that. So I couldn't have been that bad.
No kidding. Well, that's pretty
cool. Man.
That's a story you'll never forget.
Right. And now you say you talk about things that you guys, that you do for love. I can say I've taken a punch in the face for love. Not on one occasion, but 3 occasions.
Oh, what happened?
With 3 different women.
They punched you or somebody else punched you?
Punched in the face by 3 different women.
Okay.
Now, you ask yourself, what do I do so wrong that would bring it to that? Well, when it comes to relationships and arguing, I go right for the throat. I've been through marriage counseling. I was told that I fight dirty. I think that's mainly due to the way I grew up. I grew up in a pretty harsh environment. Not that, like, I didn't grow up in the ghetto or anything like that, but it was pretty, you know, low rent, white trash living area pretty much where I grew up at.
Gotcha.
You kind of had to be like busting balls and talking shit to each other. It was kind of like every day. It was an everyday occurrence. Getting into fights was a thing that happened all the time. And that attitude just kind of carries over, sadly, into some of my relationships. When I get in an argument with somebody, I go all out. It's like, I don't like yelling, but I'll say some pretty nasty shit. And it'll be stuff that I've held in for who knows how long. When it comes out, it comes out. The first time I got decked by a chick, I was dating this girl. She used to be a gang member.
Okay.
And she was all tatted up, and she was just like, if you would think of what your typical Southwestern gangster looks like, that's what she kind of looked like. She kind of dressed like just how she was. I always said I wanted a girl from the hood. Well, I got what I asked for, and it was not what I expected.
Surprise.
seriously. We were getting into a heated argument, and we were like face to face, and she hauled off and clocked me. And I looked at her like, I didn't know what to do because I've never had a woman hit me before.
Yeah.
I had no idea what. I was like, do I hit her back? What do I do? I just looked at her. I was like, yo, don't. I came up with a pretty good line. I was like, if you do that again, you won't like what happens next. Oh. I promise you. And I've used that over the years. And I'll tell you what, when you're trying to get your point across to somebody, it works.
Is that right?
It works real well. I'm not a big, scary, intimidating guy at all, but I know how to get my point across to somebody when I'm pissed off at them, and I come across hard. And I can get that from the Marine Corps too. The Marine Corps teaches you to be very direct. When you want something, tell people exactly what the fuck you want, because if you don't, a closed mouth doesn't get fed, right?
Oh, that's a good expression, but yeah, you're right.
closed mouth doesn't get fed. You know, if I've noticed in my relationships, when I want them to go a certain direction, I talk to my significant other about how the relationship is going. And I've been in relationships where both of us felt that the relationship was not going anywhere and that it should end. And that's sad when it happens. Mm-hmm. It really is, because you put a lot. You go, I'm a serial monogamist. You're with me. You're with me for a while. You know, I'll do everything I can to keep you around. But you get to a certain point where enough is enough, and you've grown apart as people, and you got to part ways. And it sucks when that happens, man. It really does, and it even sucks even worse when you realize that. So
yeah, no, you're right.
I've been in plenty of relationships where it can go, where you can swing either way. You know, and I finally settled down. I was married for a little while. That just didn't work out. And I've been with the same person now for the last 4 years, and she's a wonderful woman. She treats me really well, like probably better than I deserve. In fact, I'm sure better than I deserve.
You don't think,
I haven't been treated as well.
You don't think you deserve the good things?
Man, I ain't been no angel. I'm not the best person in the world.
Well, we've all done things we are not proud of or that we regret, but that doesn't make us bad people necessarily.
Right, right. I get that. So here's another thing about me that makes me a little interesting. I'm a recovering addict.
Okay.
I use cannabis to pretty much my final portion of my recovery. Prior to that, I was in a 12-step group for a very long time. There's been a lot of work on like self-esteem issues, mm-hmm. and rites of passage. I've done work on rites of passage issues and just generally growing up without like a role model. Mm-hmm. I guess you'd say male role model.
Yep, I can relate to that.
Yeah, my male role model was not a real actual male role model. That's I'm going to leave it at that. So it's taken me a while to build up like stuff like things like self-esteem, you know, self-worth.
Oh yes,
and I'm starting to get like me saying that I don't deserve this is actually a good thing, better than me saying something worse than that. Uh-huh. I used to say things worse. Like, I deserve to go to prison, or I deserve this, or I deserve that. You know, so nowadays, I'm just not so sure whether I deserve good things. You know what I mean? I'm grateful to come.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I really, I cherish everything I have.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I totally get the feeling of not deserving good things. I totally understand that. In fact, I'm planning on doing an episode about that in the future.
Oh, wow. That's a whole, yeah, that would be a whole episode, wouldn't it?
It definitely would be. Yes.
Done an episode on self-esteem yet?
Have I done an episode on self-esteem? I don't remember because I'm almost up to 200 on this show and over 300 on the Rusted Robots. So have I done one on self-esteem? I might have touched on it in passing, but I don't know if I've done one specifically on it. But I'd have to look through the archives.
Let's think. We can talk a little bit about it now. I mean, what is self-esteem? It's how you look at your own personality, your own self-worth, correct?
Exactly. How you feel about yourself.
Your environment. I've been through here's another quick thing about me. I've been to a psychiatric hospital before.
Oh, yes?
Yeah. That was quite an experience.
I bet it was.
And you learn stuff while you're in there. Seriously. Like I've done everything from a 12-step program to a self-help book to going to counseling to you name it. I've done it just to get myself better. All by choice too, just to have like a collection of different tools in my box. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you learn different things going through these different programs. You find out how quick your self-esteem is damaged. A lot of things affect it. Like I was saying before this, like your environment, the way you grew up, who you were surrounded by. That's what I mean by your environment and the events that took place in your life. Like you could have had a really good happy childhood. Was sent on your way to success from birth, and you got a good ride like that, and you probably worked hard, and now you earn a decent paycheck. And then there's other people who have been hurt in many different ways that aren't the most pleasant of people after so many times of being hurt. They say hurt people, right?
True.
What you get is a person who's been hurt and carries that hurt with them and displays a lot of negative aspects of that personality. Their self-esteem gets chipped away little by little. To the point where you get broken down so bad by being hurt so many times that you're not a pleasant person to be around, even though you're hurting inside and you probably need to be around people. And once again, that loneliness can bring along even lower self-esteem.
Yes.
Because you think that you don't have anybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I've definitely been there. Part of the nature of what's called the disease of addiction, which I believe it is a disease. Part of that is isolation, and an addict alone is in bad company. So I know that for a fact. So self-esteem for me is – my self-esteem is slowly but surely coming back. But it's not where I want it to be, but it's there. There's a spark there, and I'm feeling it, and it's starting to come back to me slowly because I had it a long time ago.
Okay.
Yeah,
and now you're kindling it like a small fire and fanning the flames to get back to where you were.
Pretty much. That's pretty much what I've been doing lately. For the last 4 years, I've been trying to pick myself up and get myself on the right track, and it's about time. I got to grow up sometime, right?
Well, sure. So you would describe yourself as the walking wounded on a healing journey? Or is that too dramatic?
Not that dramatic.
Okay.
No, you know, I guess this is a journey. What's a Aerosmith? Life's a journey, not a destination.
Yes.
It's hard for me to sit back and look at all this shit that I've been through in life and be sad. It really is. Because to me, it feels like I'm kind of just skipping along and enjoying things as they go, which with each new experience, no matter how good or bad they are, they're still an experience, and I get to have that.
Yes, exactly.
That's what I feel life is kind of like. It's just a series of experiences that you get to have. You know, that's part of the privilege of being able to live is you get to have experiences. You get to do things, no matter how small or big they are. Even with all the shit that I've done, there's still more out there to do, and there's still more tools I can put in my box.
Oh, of course.
And that's something I'm looking forward to. You know what I mean? I don't know what's around the corner. I'm supposed to be getting married in 9 months again. And I hope it goes the way it's supposed to go. I'm still in the middle of a divorce with my last ex-wife.
Oh.
So I'm waiting to go to – we just had a mediation today, and then we're going to go to final – we're going to get a final ruling probably in the next month. But I have to get divorced before I can get married, and my ex is kind of slow to do things. Uh-huh. So it's been a long drawn-out process. She was late. Sean, we had a mediation today, and she was a half hour late for it.
Oh, man.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah, that looks good on her.
Yeah, right. So getting married again is going to be another experience because it's I'm pretty sure you know plenty of people that are probably on their second or third marriage by now.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Like the epidemic of divorce hit in the 80s. Nobody really talks about it. You know, a lot of families got destroyed. A lot of people from my generation were like latchkey kids and had step parents and shit. I think that plays into the whole self-esteem issue quite a bit.
I would say so. You're going to be 42 next week.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just 2.5 years older than you, so I would say we're definitely the same generation. My parents weren't together either, so yeah, self-esteem issues, all that stuff. I think I can relate to everything you're talking about.
Oh, right on. I don't know. You want to go into the 12-step program?
Yeah, let's finish this episode by talking about your 12-step program.
So I went to a group called Narcotics Anonymous. I've been out of the military for about a year. I got myself pretty heavy into drugs, and it came pretty quick. My addiction came on pretty quick. Like it was just amazing how quick everything happened. I went from being at a bar, drinking all the time, to doing coke and meth like really quickly, hanging out with people and shit. I was with this girl who pretty much told me, like, get clean or get the fuck out. And at the time, I didn't have any place to go. So I went and I tried to go to another fellowship, another 12-step program, and they didn't have anybody that could come pick me up. And I was such a loser at the time, but I didn't have a car. The next best thing was Narcotics Anonymous, which was about 4 blocks down the street from me. And that's where I decided to go. I walked to my first meeting. And I walked to, like, 30 meetings after that, every day for 30 days. But it became more of a 90-day commitment. They tell you to do 90 meetings in 90 days to get in the practice of going to meetings all the time. And I didn't stay clean my first time around. I relapsed after being there for 2 months. And then I stayed clean, and I stayed clean for 7 years.
Oh, good.
And a 12-step program, a lot of people refute the 12-step program nowadays. They say it's like a cult mentality. They say some people will claim it's trying to bring you to religion. I don't think it's either or. I think it's developed to help you recover. The success rate isn't all that good, believe it or not. But I mean, if you want to stay clean, you're going to stay clean. There might be somebody struggling right now listening to your show. And if there is, there's a solution out there. It's called Narcotics Anonymous, I believe. The program helped me out tremendously. It got me on my feet. It got me networking with a bunch of people who seemed to really care, you know. And that was the biggest important, is that somebody actually gave a shit about me enough to like talk to me.
That helps, know? Right there. Feeling like you're
seriously
not alone.
Like, right. Like I didn't feel like such a loser. After going to those meetings, I didn't feel like such a loser anymore. I didn't feel like I was just the only one that these experiences were happening to. And I got to meet people who had 30 years clean and who had, you know, 20 to 30 years clean and even more. And I couldn't believe that they had lived through what they had lived through. And when you go to meetings, you hear people's stories and you really get into the meat and potatoes of things. I found out what life was really all about. You know, and how harsh it can be. I go into these meetings. And then the other thing I learned was to applaud people and their accomplishments and their joys rather than, you know, look down at them or judge them because of anything else they've done. And it's great. When you hear about somebody doing well, you cheer them on. It makes you feel good too. And trust me, I've been a hater before. Before I got into that program, I'd hate on a lot of people. Like, why does this person have that and why don't I have that? Why does this person get this? Why don't I get that? And it was all due to what's called character defects. You learn that through doing the step work as well. You learn about what your defects of character are. Mm-hmm. And they're basically your shitty side. Your shitty side. You get your shitty side out. You know what I mean? You get to talk about all the shitty parts of you and what makes you a shitty person.
That's
you're not a bad person.
Yeah, and then you make amends and you heal yourself and you heal your relationships and you get better.
Right. And there's even a step it's a daily maintenance step to make sure that you stay on track. That's pretty cool. When I did it, I had my assignment was to write in a journal every day. I had to write down, did I use? Did I hurt someone? Did I hurt somebody else? If I checked no on all three of those, it was a good day.
Yeah.
I got nothing to be worried about at the end of my day. Because it turned out to be good. Because I checked all three of those boxes. Unfortunately, I made the choice. I want to make this very clear. I made a very clear choice to use again, and it brought me to it brought me down a really long path for a really long time. And the final step to my recovery process is I go to counseling and I ingest cannabis. And cannabis helps with PTSD and some other neurological problems that I have. Puts me on the right path. And keeps me motivated and puts me to sleep when I need to. I can give you a million reasons why I have medicinal cannabis, but we could talk forever for that. And so like I said, with that and counseling, that's my journey right now. That's the experiences I'm having. Like people smoke pot to get high. I get that. I actually use mine for a purpose, and I don't overuse it. And I'm a pretty responsible adult with my marijuana now. And I think about it.
Hey, look at you go. Yeah. Right on.
Shit. Anyhow, so yeah, I mean that was my 12-step experience and that's my recovery plan now. I mean, the relationship that I'm in now mm-hmm. is different than any relationship I've ever been in before, and I think that's why it's lasted so long. I just wanted to touch on that for a second. I've never been treated with such kindness, love, and devotion from anybody that I can think of besides the woman I'm with now. And her name is Lori Basic. She's the most wonderful woman in the world, I swear to God.
And you're in a position in your life where you can appreciate it and not just throw it away.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We've been through a lot of shit. We've been through a lot of ups and downs. There was even a short period of time where we weren't together. And we found our way back to each other. And it's only because she supported me as long as she did. You know, she's been there for me through everything. And I really can't express in words how much she means to me.
Well, that's incredible. That's awesome. Maybe what we'll do is one day in the future, months and months from now, we'll have the both of you on to talk about the journey that you guys have gone on together, if she's willing to be on a show.
Okay. I think she would.
Good. Okay, cool. Because it sounds like you have a lot of stories and a lot of things to talk about. And, of course, most of my shows here are about half an hour or so, and we don't get into too much detail. But that's why we have more shows week after week. So we'd definitely like to have you back, talk about something else in depth again, if you're willing.
Absolutely.
Okay, perfect. Now, for any listeners who want to follow you on any social media, now they can find you on Two Stone Dudes Podcast, but do you have Twitter or Instagram or any of that good stuff?
Yes, I got Twitter. I'm on Twitter or on Instagram. Two Stone Dudes has a Twitter, an Instagram page. They actually do have a Twitter page too. Facebook, we have a Facebook page, and we update that almost every day. The WordPress site gets updated every time we have. You can catch us at twostonedudes.com. That's
twostonedudes.com.
Yeah, that's it.
What you should have called it was twostonedudespodcast.com.
I totally should have.
Not podcast. I don't know if I can. Podcast.
Yeah. Podcast. I like that idea. I definitely like that idea. Yeah. Every social media outlet you can think of. We're even on something called MeWe, which I encourage everybody to try out. And yeah, that's all the social media links and stuff. We're on every social media platform you think of.
Okay, perfect. Well, Ryan, thanks for being on the SoulForge podcast. I'm sure we'll have you back again. Listeners, thanks for joining us on Ryan's journey this week on the podcast. Remember to do all the things that we talk about in the end credits. And remember, education isn't something you can finish. Thank you for listening to another episode of the SoulForge podcast. Your support is greatly appreciated, and we hope you'll tune in again next time. Remember that you can visit SoulForgePodcast.com for all of our social media links. And don't forget to share the show with everyone you know. The SoulForge Podcast is your best source for living your best life.
Think about it.
This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network. Be part of the crew and help support our shows by donating to our ESO Patreon or by shopping for the TeePublic store, which can all be found at www.esonetwork.com. The ESO Network, your station for all things geek.